Hello, you malty mad hatters. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 240, and thank you to the symbolist one for that malt mention. Introducing, as it does, Whisky Review 240, the concluding vlog, that's video blog, vlog, of a series on dead distilleries. And our dead distillery representative today is, cue the drum roll, Dallas Dew. This is a Cadenhead bottling. Cadenheads have quite a considerable range of whiskies, which they bottle independently, and of course rums and cognacs and other stuff too, being one of Scotland's most venerable and antiquated. What is antiquated? That sounds a bit demeaning, doesn't it? Venerable and antique. Yes, independent bottlers. Standards vary, as they do with all independent bottlers, but bear in mind, you can get some wonderful surprises in the independent bottlings of some seriously good single malt whisky from less well-known distilleries. This is a splendid example. Dallas Dew is a dead distillery. Now, if you've been following this series, you'll note, remember that in Whisky Review 337, I mentioned that one of the dead distilleries was completely dead, another of the distilleries was half dead, and the third of the distilleries was pretending to be dead. Now, Rosebank's completely dead, Brora's half dead, but the one that's pretending to be dead is Dallas Dew. And I'm going to tell you the reason why after I've given you the tasting notes. This was distilled in 1979. It's 24 years old, and it was bottled in... Oops, I can't even read it because... Where's my magnifying glass? Where's my steampunk magnifying glass? Here it is. I'll be able to read it now. In January 2004. Although I did actually buy this relatively recently. So it's been hanging around in shop shelves for quite a while. It's been matured in a bourbon cask. So I'm getting these vanilla and custardy, creamy vanilla notes. And it's at a whacking great 61.4%. Question is, if Angel's share is approximately 2% per year losses, how can a 24-year-old whisky have as high a concentration of alcohol as 61.4%? Sometimes people are asking these questions, and I'm going to tell you why. Because alcohol losses through evaporation from casks varies considerably. The 2% is simply a predefined unit of calculation for customs and excise in calculating duty payable on the spirit. There you go. Now you know. Bit more water, actually. 61.4%, but not too much, because this is an old whiskey. Nose. Syrupy. Leather oak. Furniture polish. You're immediately getting age on the nose. Old age, old cask. I'm getting the impression that, a strong impression actually, that this isn't a first fill bourbon cask. This is a bourbon cask that has already been used first time round, and maybe this is the second time, or perhaps even the third time it's been used for maturing spirit. So if this was distilled in 1979, it's possible that the cask had previously been maturing whiskey for, say, for example, off the top of my head, 12 years, which would take us back to 1967, that the bourbon cask had first had whiskey in it. Now, if it was 1967 and it had been maturing bourbon, then the original bourbon from this oak cask from which I'm getting this whiskey could have been made by the cooper in the mid-1960s, or even earlier. There you go. But that sense of age, of decades, you're really getting it powerfully in the nose here. And it's taken a while as the bottle goes down before for it to become prominent. But it's along with that, you've got this rich barley malt graininess and a sweetness that's typical of Speyside whiskies. Incidentally, Dallas Dew is just along the road from Benromach Distillery. So that gives you a point of reference. Fragrant creme brulee, overripe apples, stewed tea, vanilla cream, hint of licorice actually. Some mint chocolate. I don't know if you, there's a British sweetie called After Eights. It's a kind of green rectangular box. And you've got these wafer thin dark chocolate mints. That's what I'm getting, After Eight mints. And a tiny drop of peat. With water, you get some dry ginger, sawdust, leather and polish. So the water added to that whiskey will bring out the old notes in it, particularly the kind of the wood derived age notes, the leather, sawdust, and the furniture polish. Taste. Intense. Very fruity. Definitely. Not a fresh fill cask. Some little wonderful soft pastel, fruit pastel notes. Very ripe syrupy malt, wild strawberries, very ripe wild strawberries, pineapple, papaya, raisin and cherry cola candy. With the addition of water, some bitter wood becomes more prominent. Vanilla, definitely, some maple rock and raisin. So, a real, genuine, old-school, sweet, fruity, typical Speyside whiskey, which has been well-made and it shows. It survived the years beautifully. The intensity is the vitality of this malt. It is just wonderful. It really is. Thoroughly enjoying this. 91 out of 100, and that, yes, a malt mark. Lovely. Dallas Dew. I think a lot of the vitality and the youthfulness, the freshness after 24 years has got to do with the fact that it was a refill cask, but importantly, it's a high strength of alcohol. Alcohol, the more alcohol there is in old casks, the stronger the old cask whiskey, then the more intact the original spirit signature is from that particular distillery. So if this, for example, had been a Dallas Dew near at 41 or 42%, I would expect to see far less fresh barley spirit presence and much more of the cask dominating the experience. That is just opinion, of course, and we love opinions. Dallas Dew Distillery is a distillery pretending to be dead. Rosebank, totally dead. Brora, half dead. But the reason that Dallas Dew is pretending to be dead is for the simple reason that it is at this moment in time completely intact as a distillery. Remarkably intact. All the major equipment is there. It looks like a museum piece for the simple reason that's what Dallas Dew is. It's a museum owned by a quango on behalf of the government. And I visited it last year when I was in Scotland, going around Speyside, a few of the distilleries. And I thought it was fascinating to get the kind of the ghost-like effect of a completely empty silent distillery, and yet the stills are there, the notice boards, the health and safety boards are there, the fire extinguishers are there, the warehouses are there. There's even a large container, and this is very unusual. There's a large kind of vat, about 2 metres across and a metre deep, and it's got a little propeller in it. And that is the original yeast cultivator that old distilleries used to have, because they manufactured in their own supply of yeast rather than relying on yeast imported from the suppliers in sacks, as all modern distilleries do. I can't think of a single Scotch whisky distillery who actually cultivate their own style of yeast in-house. But if Dallas Dew was to restart as a distillery, it could do that. It would create jobs, it would create revenue, and it would have even more visitors than it does now. Because when you're in an area of whisky production surrounded by working distilleries, people don't really want to go and see a distillery that isn't working when they've got the option of visiting one where the stills are hot, where the sounds are there, the boiler's working, people are working, creating the stuff. It really tells you a lot about where Scotland's at with whisky. To visit Dallas Dew and know that you're in an area of relatively high unemployment, and yet here you have a distillery which could be working literally in a couple of months' time, but it's not. It's just silent and still. It's a museum piece, and it shouldn't be that. It really shouldn't. What a missed opportunity. What a wasted resource. How very Scottish. Scotland, incidentally, is having a referendum in 2014 relating to independence. It'll be interesting to see what happens, because whether Scotland, Scottish people, vote for independence or vote not to be independent, whichever way they vote, whatever the decision is, there's going to be very significant changes. And it would certainly help to have all your resources up and running and doing something. So fingers crossed, malt mates, fingers crossed that Dallas Dew can get distilling again, because as a small craft distillery, it would provide for the malt table yet another delightful, beautiful personality single malt, which has so ably represented in this bottle here. There we go. Phew! Oh. I hope that didn't sound like too much of a Ralphie rant. Thank you for watching. I hope you'll join me again shortly for Whisky Review 341, in which we will be starting a brand new mini-series relating to whisky. Or it might be bourbon. Or it might be vodka. It might be grappa. I don't know. You know what? I've not even made my mind up yet what I'm going to do. I don't just like to keep you in suspense as to what's going to happen next. I like to keep myself in suspense. It's a challenge, you see. Do I proceed perhaps with some more single malts? Perhaps some blends? Or do we go in a completely different direction and start to discuss something which I've not discussed before? Only time will tell, and you will have to be returning here in a few days' time to check out Whisky Review 341 to find out. Thank you for watching. Goodbye and take care.